Dear beloved Muslims, assalamu alaikum.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar,
Allahu Akbar,
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayyalel salah. Hayyalel salah. Hayyalel falah. Hayyalel falah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah.
أعوذ بالله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل له فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I seek refuge in Allah against the accursed shaitan. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah. And I bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his true servant and his last apostle. This, what I just read, it says that surely Allah, with Allah, we seek his help and his forgiveness. We seek help in Allah against the evils of our own nafs, or the evils of our own souls. And we seek the help of Allah against the evils of our, and the consequences of our bad actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can lead astray. And whomsoever Allah leads astray, none can guide. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, his true servant and his last apostle, and I bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his true servant and his last apostle. So with that, I'd like to greet the believers here at Ali Khan Islamic Center with our greetings of peace and paradise of assalamu alaikum. Okay. Dear beloved Muslims, today I'm going to read from Surah 16, Ayats 120 to 123. So just bear with me, please. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna Ibrahim ma kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifan wa lam yakun minal mushrikeen شاكرا لنبيه اشتبه وهداه الى صراط مستقيم وأتيناه في دنيا حسنة وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين ثم أوحينا إليك إن يتبع ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين صدق الله العلي العظيم. I seek refuge in Allah against the accursed Shaitan. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. It says, surely the prophet Ibrahim, was a model of virtue, obedient to Allah, upright. He was not of the polytheists, grateful for Allah's favors. He chose him and guided him on the right path. And we gave him good in this world, and in the hereafter he is surely among the righteous. Then we revealed to thee, talking about a revelation coming to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Follow the faith of Abraham, the upright one. And he was not of the polytheist. So Allah, the Most High, revealed to the Prophet Muhammad in terms of religious matters is to follow the way of the Prophet Ibrahim. He said, follow his way. That is your way. That is your path to salvation, if you want to use that word. That is your path of gaining closeness or proximity to me, is to follow the way of the Prophet Ibrahim, or the Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him. Now, there are a few key words. Let me move this junk out of it. And oh, no, by the way, people, let's remember silence our telephones. Okay, let's silence that telephone. So if you haven't done it, let's do it right now. The first thing we want to talk about is this word here. It says that Ibrahim was Imam. He was a leader. He was a model. He was the best example for mankind. Okay? Let me say it again. Ibrahim was an example. He was an imam, a leader, and a model, and the best example for mankind. The Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or peace be upon him, referred to Ibrahim as being his father. One of his fathers. He had two fathers. The Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, and the Prophet Ibrahim. He referred to them as his father. Because Abraham's example, in terms of true faith, a true iman, was the example that Allah himself, he says he's right here in the Quran, instructed the Prophet to follow. Is the example of Ibrahim. Why so? In Islam, we have five supporting pillars of faith. The last one is the pillar or the supporting foundation called the Hajj. The Hajj is when we make that once-in-a-lifetime journey to Mecca. Now let me back up a little bit and just share with those who may not be so familiar the history of Mecca and the Kaaba, the first house built by the Prophet Adam alayhi salam. Let's talk about that. The first house of worship was built by Adam. The prophet Adam. In a land that's now known as became known as the Hijaz, and later on Saudi Arabia through the events of politics. But it was the first house that was built for the exclusive worship of Allah. And in time, through neglect and the degradation of humanity, the house was lost. Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, being a man of strong and true faith, or iman, or sincere service and trust in Allah, blessed him to be a prophet, to be his servant, to be not just a prophet, to be a special servant. But if you're going to be a special servant, comes with a special trial, a task. The prophets, peace be upon all of them, are tried and tested more than any of us. It's the prophets. They're tested the most. His first test is growing into an old age. Being a man of God, being a man of sincere iman. He grew old, being childless. No man. I think he must have been maybe about 90 years old, according to some scholars. He's an old man. And that, according to today's standards, that's old. He's about 90 years old. Didn't have a child. So, he prayed to Allah, as was his practice, as was his method. He prayed to Allah. And as a consequence, his wife Sarah was inspired. That comes from this word, awha, inspiration. It just comes in a bang, just like a flash, like the revelation. The revelation comes in a flash, just like a flash, just like a lightning bolt, boom, it's there. Sarah, his wife Sarah, being the obedient woman that she was, consented that he could conceive a child, since she had grown old and barren by today's standards, consented that he could bear a child by their handmaiden Hajar. She consented to it. So one thing led to another, and the child was born. Fast forwarding it. The child was born. And the child's name was Ishmael. In the course of time, Sarah became a little bit somewhat envious of the attention that Ibrahim was showing Hajar in preference to her. Moving it forward to the point that she could no longer bear or no longer wanted Hajar in the household. She said, Ibrahim, I don't care what you do with her. I don't want her around here. Just a natural human emotion. It's not a judgment call. She doesn't have a woman around here. You gotta do something with her, but she can't stay here. Ibrahim was in constant contact and connection and saw only Allah, which is the state of one who has arrived at taqwa. You see Allah and only Allah. Although to us it might look strange or different or absurd, some things that happen to us, but with the muttaqin, the one who has obtained taqwa, you see only Allah. Only Allah. You hear only Allah. You taste your, all of your senses and faculties experience only Allah. Only Allah. So Allah instructed Ibrahim to take Hajar and the newborn baby child Ishmael to a barren land, uninhabitable land, and just leave her there. And that was the first test of Ibrahim. That's the first, I'm not going to say the first test, but that was a big test. He's probably been tested many, 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 many times, but that was a big test. Take her to this certain place and leave her there. Did Ibrahim question Allah? Of course not. With respect to the muttaqin, the one who has obtained taqwa, if the matter is, you just hear and you obey. So he says, take it and leave her there. Trust me, which is one of the prime ingredients of taqwa, is based upon trust. Trust me. Take her here and just leave her there. I will take care of her. Now, of course, with some of us who may not have arrived at that state of consciousness, there will be another voice, which we'll talk about later, which will come in and question that move. But Abraham's move was based upon trust. Okay. So he took her there and he left her there. Now, when it comes to Hajj, I remember making Hajj, oh, I'm not gonna tell you how many years ago, because I'll be telling my age. But the first time I made Hajj, the leader that led our delegation to the Hajj, Imam Warfdeen Muhammad, this is the first time we had made Hajj. He told us back then, he said, look, don't just come over here, and I'm pretty sure some of those of us who have made Hajj under other learning leaders have told you the same thing. Don't just come over here and just go through these rituals without understanding or feeling the meaning, the deeper meaning that surrounds these rituals. This is not a ritual. There's a lesson here. There's a teaching here in this Hajj, in this journey to Mecca. There's a lesson here. Learn the inner lesson. Just don't walk through, go through and do this, do that, and come back home and say all you did was this, that, and the other. You see, because if you did, you just missed things. So the first thing, one of the rituals that we go through, thank you there, good brother, is a ritual called running between the two mountains. Running between the two mountains. Safa and Marwa, I think that's the name of it. Whereas that you, at a certain point in the precincts, you run in between these two small mountains. And then running in between these two small mountains represents the running up between the two mountains that the Hajar, the companion of Ibrahim, had to do when she was looking for provisions for her child. Now, mind you now, she's on the desert. Nothing there but sand as far as you can see. There's nothing there. But she ran in between these two mountains looking for some provisions for that child. Just looking. But in her looking, And in her searching, she trusted Allah. Trust again. She trusted Allah and only Allah. She trusted Allah from the first point of view by going to this place, agreeing to go to this place. She trusted Allah. And in her trust, Allah made a way out of no way. That comes from trust. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Angel came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, so, O Prophet, we will give you all the gold that you want, and you can still obtain the Jannah, the paradise. We'll give you all the gold that you want. The Prophet Muhammad denied. He says, no. I prefer poverty over all this gold. Now let me explain to you what that means. That doesn't mean being in a poor state of mind, a welfare state of mind. His mindset or his attitude that if you give me this gold, then I won't trust in Allah. If you give me this gold, I would rather be in a position talking about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or peace be upon him, to be in a position or a situation where I have to continuously exercise the muscle of trust. That's what his position was. So he denied though the gold or any worldly benefits in order to be in a situation where you continuously have to trust in Allah. And that trust is one of the prime ingredients that builds what they call taqwa, or a state of mind that we see, feel, taste nothing but Allah. Taqwa, that condition or that state of soul, is the state or the condition that the soul is taken from stage to stage. It's the condition of the soul that the soul needs in order to make this a successful, peaceful transition from this life into the next. It has to have taqwa, or be in a state of observance to Allah. So Ibrahim had it. Hajar had it. Eventually, the child began to grow old, and as the child, the Prophet Ishmael, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reached the stage of somewhat puberty, the puberty age, or where you start, you know, when you start realizing that you are, you know, your manly traits start to develop. The Prophet Ibrahim, there was wanted Allah to show him the site of the house where Abraham, the Prophet had built. So he sent a meteorite. You all know the story, right? You all know the story? The story is this, is when the Prophet Abraham was looking for the site of the first house that was built by the Prophet Adam for his worship, his exclusive worship, he sent a meteorite to show him or point out where the house was. And that meteorite that was sent down is now known as the sacred black stone. Y'all with me so far? So, the Prophet Ibrahim and his son Ishmael, based upon trust and faith of Allah, began to reconstruct the first house built for his worship. A house that's built upon trust in Allah. If we don't know anything in this life, if we never learn to trust Allah or depend totally on Allah for everything, for all of our needs, it is, oh Allah, you alone do we serve. And it is you alone that we seek for help. It is a lie. If we're in a situation of trial or crisis, we depend on Allah and only Allah, as compared to the situation when the slave girl Hajar was placed in the desert and she didn't know where it was going to come from. But eventually a well sprung up. The baby kicked in the sand and a well sprung up. A well of water, sweet water. And this water not only satisfied their needs for the time being, but became a resource for her to make a living for herself, because eventually that land became a center point for trade, and travelers would come through, and she would sell the water to these travelers. So Allah made a way of no way, you see. So if we take a look, or really look into the meaning of the Hajj, is all built on taqwa, gaining closeness to Allah, trusting Allah always, knowing that He sees us even when we don't see Him. He sees us. He hears us when we don't think He hears us. So it's about trust. Then there comes patience. It says here in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم واصبر وما صبرك إلا بالله ولا تقزموا عليكم ولا تكو في سبك مما يبقرون إن الذين مع الذين نفعوا والذين لكم المؤسنين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. It said, and be patient. This is the command of Allah. Waspir. When we see a command of Allah, He's not asking us, He's telling us, be patient. And thy patience is not but by the help of Allah. So the first thing of taqwa is what? Complete trust. And with His help, He grants us the muscle of patience. Patience is an exercise. It has strengthens us. It has results. It's not passive. It's not passivity. It's not sitting back waiting for something to happen. It's a muscle. It builds us, builds our strength. It builds our trust. Patience. And grieve not for them, nor be in stress for what they plan, speaking about the unbelievers. Surely Allah is with those who keep their duty. Duty, and the word here, duty, is the word that comes from the taqwa. Surely Allah is with those who keep their duty. That keep that taqwa, or develop that taqwa, or that faith, or that complete whole reliance on Allah, and those who do good to others. And surely Allah speaks the truth. So with taqwa, we have three main ingredients, and I've said this over and over again, and I will continue to say it over and over and over again. There are three ingredients. You have complete and total trust in Allah. Complete trust in all things, no matter what it is, having trust in Allah. Then there's patience, or sabur. And then there's gratitude, as it says in Ayat 121, that Abraham was grateful for his favors. He showed gratitude. He chose him and guided him on Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path. So that, dear believers, is our lesson for the day, so to speak. It's a lesson of taqwa. Just as the first house was built on taqwa, and what happened? One of the meanings of Hajj is this, it's proof. This is why it's the last pillar or the last of our requirements. It is a proof. It is a proof, brothers, we got to have some silence out there. It is a proof of the works of Allah. It's a testimony to what we have been doing. It is a proof. So the first house was built on taqwa, right? And now it is the most frequented place on the planet Earth. Those of us who have been there, we see people coming from everywhere, which was the answer to the prophet Ibrahim as a result of taqwa. If we have taqwa, excuse the expression, if we have taqwa in our own lives, strong taqwa, I mean taqwa that's acceptable, or reliance on Allah that's acceptable to Allah, He will bless our generations. I guess I just have to check up the testosterone. See, but if we have trust in Allah, He will bless our generations to come. You know, I hear a lot of times, thank you, dear Brother John. I didn't think it was me, you know. But He will bless our generations. A lot of times you hear, says, oh, I got a child. My children don't want to be Muslims. I tried hard. I sent them to Islamic school. I sent them to Claire Muhammad school. But as soon as they got of age, they didn't want to be Muslims no more. Where is the grace of Allah? Where is the mercy of Allah? I did all of this, and look, my kids have gone astray. They're out there in the dunya, they're doing this, and they're doing that. Well, that might be that generation. Now, I tell you this for a fact. Sometimes a generation will get skipped. What you mean by skipped? All right, this child, your first child, that we tried so hard to make a Muslim. That might have been a mistake right there. We tried too hard to make him a Muslim. But they chose something else, to do something else. It may be that grandchild that comes along and says sincerely, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, in the children generations after that. So don't think that our works are in vain, because they're not. Because if we have true, sincere taqwa, Allah will bless that taqwa through the generations like He did the prophet Ibrahim. All of His children that came along weren't believers. There were some who fell into error, to this, to that, to back into idol worship, but there were many who did. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a direct descendant of the prophet Ibrahim. Prophet Isa, the one we come to know as Jesus the Christ, is a direct descendant of the prophet Ibrahim. Okay, so let's not take our taqwa for granted, okay? So when we think about Hajj, look into the meaning of Hajj. Look at Prophet Ibrahim and his manners, why he was made to be the model to follow. All praise is due to Allah, Lord of all the world. So that is that with taqwa. So as we, in our quest to expand this community right here, we're building this community upon taqwa. If you wanted to have a strong, lasting foundation, it has to be built upon taqwa. It has to be built upon total reliance and service to Allah. It has to be built upon taqwa. Praise be to Allah. Hope we understand. I want to greet my guests here today. Thank you all for coming, and I want you, don't feel embarrassed if I single you out, but first of all, I would try and start with those of you all here for the first time. Thank you for coming. We appreciate the fact that you have come to spend Juma at Al Anon Islamic Center. And inshallah, we hope that this will not be your last time. Okay? So thank you very much. We really appreciate your presence. We have with us today our brother Emil Rahman Khan. Don't let that smile go all the way off your face. You know, his sister Ophelia's youngest. Okay, Rahman Khan. We're glad that you come to visit us, Rahman Khan. And also we have here my brother Tawheed. You know, Tawheed was for a little while a student of mine. How long ago was that, Tawheed? About 25 years ago. He's about 25. Yeah, no, it's about 25. The mid-90s is when I kind of got here. Yeah, the mid-90s. Okay, 30-something, you was in your diapers. Okay, and so I'd like to thank you for coming with us, Brother Tawheed. I'm glad to see you come up to grow up to be the strong, fine man that you have become. You know, I remember you. You know, I remember you way back when. Okay, and it's my brother Abdul Razak. Oh, brother Najee Abdul Rahman. Thank you for coming, spending time with us. You know, any more of you all who I have missed, thank you for coming. Thank you very much. You know, we really appreciate the fact that you have come here, that you have joined us in worship, okay? If I overlooked you, please forgive me. Okay, now, the second thing I want to talk about, time is moving on, and I'm going to get you out of here by 2 o'clock, is we want to remember our zakat. Now, let me just frame it up a little bit. We are trying to expand this facility. What am I saying? Expand this facility. Expand out of this facility. Let me get that straight. Because as you all can see, our facility now is, we've outgrown it, to make a long story short. So in our efforts to outgrow or to expand, we're asking for people to make donations, whatever is in your heart. If you want to donate towards that expansion, specify your donation to go to our building expansion fund. Sometimes people will say, if you want a facility that's going to cost something like $1 million, where is it going to come from? Who are we going to borrow it from? That's the question that comes up. But you know what I tell them? I go back to our basic fundamentals. How did the Kaaba get built? How was it maintained? It was built by trust and total reliance on Allah. And He will make a way of no way, just like He did with Hajar and the baby child, if we have that trust. Because He knows what we need. He knows that we are expanding. He knows that we are growing. He knows what we need. He knows exactly who to send here each and every Juma. So, if Allah touches our heart, if Allah inspires our hearts to give, please give for the sake of Allah. But make sure that your gift goes towards, just don't throw the money in the bucket and say, Fisa Billah. Don't do that. What you want to do is you want to make sure that the money that you give is specified for the expansion fund. Okay? We're gonna get out of here. Number two, we have what they call operating expenses here. Now, in the past, there have been certain ones of us who have donated, have committed to contribute a certain amount of money per month for expansion. Not expansion, for just general operating funds. That is the rent, the lights, any other utilities, any operating expense that we need. So if you want to, we'd like for you to contribute to that too, because this building doesn't run on As-Salaamu Alaikum. It runs on your generous donations. Okay, very good. All right, now, pray for the sick and shut in. We're moving on. Pray for the sick and shut in. We have a men's Hanukkah class here. I would say it starts roughly around 10 o'clock to 12, okay? Now, tomorrow morning, we're going to have, during those hours from 10 to 12, we're going to have an Imam's meeting. If you come, you just come, okay? But we're having an Imam's meeting, okay? Yeah, I'll do it, Please move forward, brothers. We have an Imam's meeting from 10 to 12, okay? And what we're going to discuss at that Imam's meeting is the future and the methods in making commitments to move this, to help this Ummah expand, okay? We have that. We have Tatlin service from 11 to 12 on Sunday. We have a boxing class for those of you who have interest, have youth or children who are interested in learning how to box. That takes place on Wednesday, 7 to 8, Saturday from 10 to 12, and Sundays from 12 to 1:30. Okay, the Arabic, and we also have an Arabic class on Sunday. From 10 to 11, okay, a basic Arabic class. Sundays, 10 to 11. Now, the last thing I want to do, and I'm trying to get through this thing in 4 or 5 minutes, is we want to talk about protocol or manners. What do I mean by protocol or manners? Friday, let me explain to you, let me just say this. There's a hadith, or saying of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It goes something like this. Friday, first of all, is the best day. It is the most blessed day. And on that particular day, there are two angels that wait at the front door. Every Friday, they wait at the front door. We may not necessarily see them, but they wait at the front door. They come through here all the time. But these particular angels, they wait at the front door, and they wait there for a certain reason. They wait there for the reason is they take down the names. Now, because Allah knows, let me just back up. They know that Allah knows best our situation, okay? This is not a chastisement, it's just something for the record. But the angels take down the names of those who enter the masjid before the imam sits down and says, assalamu alaikum. That's not to say you won't get blessed for coming to Juma, but if you want that special blessing, that extra credit, so to speak, because if we just try to make it to Juma with a sincere intent, Allah blesses us always. So I'm not saying that. He always blesses us to some degree or another. But these angels wait for those who get there before the imam sits down and says, assalamu alaikum. And they write this down and they take it back to Allah for extra credit on Yawm al-Qiyam, or the Day of Judgment. Okay? Back in the old days, not long after the advent of the Prophet, on the day of Friday, people would start lining up to come to Juma right after Fajr prayer. You can see people coming to the masjid before the sun had even risen because they wanted that extra blessings from Allah. They came with their best spirit. They came in their best dress. You see, to receive the blessings of Allah. The last thing I want to talk about is respect. Respect. Specifically, is respect that, or protocol, that insists upon the youth respecting your elders. Okay? Respecting your elders. When I was growing up in the church, if I disrespected an elder, or ran around, or I was running around, you all too, if you all running around, acting up, and someone told you to sit down, behave yourself because you're making a noise, you sat down. You see, and if you didn't, at least in my case, they would give my mother a phone call and say, Ms. Pratt, your son was running around such and such. I told him to stop running around. And they talked back to me and just acted like they didn't hear me. And she would sit me down and let me know, boy, let me tell you something. When you do that, you bring shame on me. That's the way she would put it. She knew how to use her words to hurt you. Yeah, my father had a whole one-size-fit-all solution to all of that. You see. But my mother would sit down and she would talk to you, son, this hurts me. You bring shame on me when you do that. So I say this to say this. If you have small children or young children, you are in charge of those children. Those children are to respect the adults in authority. Because if they don't learn respect at an early age, they don't stand a chance as they get older. Okay? When they get to a certain point. So we want to talk about respect. The children must learn to respect their adults. If an adult tells you, if a respected adult, God forbid it be an elder, tells you to do something, it's one thing submitting or talking, I hear and obey. No back talk, no cursing back, none of that stuff. You do what that elder says do. If you cannot do what that elder says do or respect that authority, you have no business in here. And the ones who are encouraging it or allowing it to happen have no business in here also. Because if that sort of thing goes on, we cannot grow into the respectful community that we should be. Prophet Muhammad, this is the last hadith because we're out of time, had a slave servant, an African slave servant. And sometimes the children, his grandchildren, would call the servant by his first name. Prophet Muhammad would pull them aside and say, look here, don't you call that man by his first name. You refer to him as uncle. That's what you refer to him as, your uncle. So let's keep that in mind. There's a hierarchy of respect. Do I show respect for elders? I most certainly do. There's a lady that lives in the block in the neighborhood that I grew up in, and she says, boy, I want you to come see me every time you come. And she still calls me boy. When you come home, when you visit Chicago, you make sure you come see me. You better believe I'm making my attempt to get there. Respect the elders, okay? Inshallah, if I said anything that's of good, it's from Allah. And if I said anything that may not be so good, then it's from my nafs. I thank you all very much for being here. Aqim al-Salah.
Wait, hold on. We don't want to do this now. We don't make a practice out of this. Okay, but what do we need?
You need to sit. You need to sit.
Oh, yes, yes. Okay, you're right. Forgive me. I want to sit and do a prayer. I'm sorry, brother. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, too, Hamza. Okay, all right. I'm wrong, my bad. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد فاته لما ولك والخاتم من سبق الناس الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين أقم الصلاة Okay, brothers, after this goodbye, There's going to be another khutbah starting about 2:15. Okay? Thank you.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Move ahead. Fill in the gaps.
As your hand to Allah, as your hand to Muhammad Rasulullah, as your hand to Muhammad Rasulullah.
Move up, fill in the gaps.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. Stow. Step up, brother.
Okay, brothers, how are we living in the back?
One moment.
You don't have enough space for them. Disturb the light. Okay, if there's an overflow, we have an overflow room now.
We good?
We good.
All right, very
good. No gaps, fellas.
Y'all got enough space. مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا احد. الله اكبر. سمي الله لمن حمدا. الله اكبر. الله اكبر. الله اكبر.
الله اكبر.
Allahu Akbar. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanirrahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح أرأيت ناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فاستأذن بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. الله أكبر.
الله أكبر.
سبح الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر.
الله أكبر.
الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Okay, dear believers, let us say Al-Fatiha before we leave. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Go in peace. Allahu Akbar.
Wa alaikum salam.